trying to imagine whether we could succeed in pulling a lot of people from the community together and our larger tri-state community. We didn't dream that we would do as much of this as we've accomplished. So thank you all for coming. My name is Alex Wilson. I'm the founder, a little over 30 years ago, of Building Green, a Brattleboro-based company that does consulting and provides information on the green building, for the green building community. I'm also founder in 2012 of the Resilient Design Institute, which focuses on how to make buildings and communities more resilient to climate change and interruptions in our power and whatnot. I'm also chair of the leadership team of the Ecovation Hub, which you'll be hearing a lot more about as we go through the afternoon. So the meeting here is the Milestone 3 meeting of the Ecovation Hub. We previously were referring to this as the Green Economy Innovation Hub. We did a branding exercise. Joe Hesland led that, who's in the back here, and came up with a pithier name that might be easier to remember. The autocorrect on my email still turns it into Evocation Hub. So I'm working on that, but anyway, thank you, Joe, for that work. And thank you, Brattleboro Savings and Loan, for funding that branding exercise. And Dan Yates is here, who you'll be hearing from later. So the impetus for this economic development initiative was to replace jobs that are being lost through the closure of Vermont Yankee, and to replace those jobs within the so-called green economy. So jobs that relate to green building, to resilience, to sustainable farming, to a lot of different areas, wood products, resource-based industry, and to do so within a four-county area in southern Vermont, Cheshire County in New Hampshire, and Franklin County in western Mass. So it's somewhat unique as initiatives go in that it spans three different states and four counties. It's not just a Brattleboro or a Windham County or even a Vermont initiative. And that lends some breadth to it and new opportunities that wouldn't avail themselves if it was just Windham County or just Brattleboro. So this is the Milestone 3 meeting, and we're going to hear reports from five different action teams that have been working for close to 10 months now in looking at what the business opportunities might be to build economic growth within this so-called green economy. Those you see here, I think we've got 70 or 80 people here. This represents a sampling of those who have been involved. We have, I think, over 300 people on our email distribution list now, people that have been involved in one aspect or another of this initiative. So again, to all you here, thank you so much. And to others, we all owe a deep debt of gratitude to the long hours that have been put in. I'll introduce Frank Knott as well. Frank is with Vital Economy in Baltimore. Vital Economy has been a consultant to the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation in facilitating this whole initiative and really moving it forward and lighting the fire under us. And he and his colleague Jim Hagwood have put in hundreds of hours beyond what the contract called for. So he really believes in the mission that we're doing and wants to see this a success and is putting his time and effort toward that beyond the contract he has. So again, thank you all. And before we get started, I wanted to step back for just a minute and reflect on one of the reasons why we're doing this. You know, here it is, late October. The forecast for today was that it was supposed to get close to 80 degrees in Brattleboro. I don't think it quite made that, but it was 76 at our farm in Dummerston yesterday. And globally, 2016 is on track to be the warmest year on record by far, and significantly exceeding global temperatures from last year, which set an all-time record not only for the magnitude, but for the difference from last year compared to the previous warmest year on record. So, you know, global climate change is here, and, you know, that calls for changes in our economy and changes in our business structure. And what we're looking at in this tri-state initiative are opportunities that, you know, do well by doing good. You know, a lot of the projects we'll be talking about, you know, will ultimately help to reduce carbon emissions or in other ways help prepare us for a changing climate and make money doing so and employ people doing so. So I'm excited about that, and I think it's important for us to, you know, keep in mind these broader reasons why we're all here. So we have a packed schedule this afternoon. We're not going to go around the room and introduce everyone as much as I'd love to do that. There are a bunch of new faces here, and I'm hoping that people will stick around after the meeting. We have some informal networking time, and there's also going to be a short break midway through the meeting. You'll meet members of the leadership team and action team members in the reporting out that we'll have in a few minutes. But before we get to that, I want to give Laura Sebelia an opportunity to talk a little bit about the CEVEDS connection and SEDS, the Economic Development Initiative that she leads. Laura is with the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation. BDCC has been the convener of this initiative. It's the regional economic development organization serving this part of Vermont. And Laura and others, including Adam Grenold at BDCC, worked hard to bring in funding to support this initiative. And she wants to talk about those connections with CEVEDS and SEDS. So Laura.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hopefully you'll be able to hear me. I know there's a few familiar faces from this morning. We had a meeting in Keene this morning, 7:30. Hands up on that meeting. Thank you. Nice to see you again today. That was put on by the Keene Chamber, truly looking at a tri-state region event effort here. Great event, giving folks a picture of what's going on here, a little preview of today's event. So I don't want to take up a lot of time from you, but I do want to kind of wind back just a little bit so we can connect to the work that we are currently doing. How many folks here are familiar with CEVEDS? That's a lot. Okay. And how many CEVEDS board members, actually, past, present? Great. So given the large number of folks, what I will do is, I think, talk a little bit about the SEDS, the Federally Recognized Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy that was completed by CEVEDS in 2014. It was a regional effort that focused on prioritizing working with all of our towns in Windham County, as well as growing the size and quality of our workforce, and focusing on replacing jobs lost with the VY closure by focusing on some key industries that we had significant assets in the region. Healthcare, technology-driven precision manufacturing, and the green building sector. We have been working since 2014 with a number of folks in this room, Guy, Alex, a number of folks from Building Green, Candace Frank, on developing a project, means of developing this grassroots asset mapping and future planning to grow this industry sector. And we were really pleased to bring funding in 2015, working with the U.S. Economic Development Administration, the state of Vermont, leveraging some of the VY settlement funds, as well as a significant investment from BDCC. That project, in addition to this piece, has two other pieces. We've done an accelerator feasibility study with Vital Economy, which we're looking to tie in here through the work of R.T. Brown and the Windham County Economic Development Program, looking to make that a tri-regional effort that can assist this work. And we've also done a tri-region SEDS assessment with our neighbors in Franklin County and Cheshire County. And we're looking forward to opportunities to continue the collaboration moving forward with this. So with that, I wanted to touch back, and I will now introduce Candace Pearson, who's going to point us forward.
So, as Laura mentioned, this initiative was launched back in August of 2015. So we now have a whole year of work that we've been doing, and this is milestone 3. And other people have been laying the groundwork for years. So I want to take a moment to recognize why we're all here, how far we've been able to come in this last year, and then what our next steps are for the next phase of the project. So we're all here on a Tuesday for a 3-hour-long meeting because we all relate to this vision. And the vision is that our region can become a recognized national leader in creating resilient, sustainable buildings and communities. So that's our personal motivation. And that's a really big vision. And as we worked with some of you all in our action teams, it became pretty clear that it was useful to be really specific about the target of this initiative. And that target's really to attract capital and nurture businesses. And that comes from our SEVEDS connection. But we want to do that in a way that's in balance with our environmental resources. And if we're successful in that, then I think we can achieve this vision. So as I said, our primary goals are really economic. Due to some of the economic research that Vital Economy has done, we know that our region, the 4-county region, is a $10 billion economy, and we want to be able to get to a $12 billion economy. So that's very up here at the top of the pyramid. We know that a lot of factors have to go to be put in place to get to that end goal, and that's including growing the total number of jobs, it includes retaining young professionals in the region, and it includes growing the total population. And because of the time that we've had in the last year, we've also been able to see that the green economy can contribute to those goals a certain percentage. So this bottom of the green pyramid are the metrics that our initiative, Ecovation Hub, can contribute. And we have very specific goals, economic goals in terms of that. You guys have seen this before. There are goals in terms of retaining college graduates, growing total numbers of jobs, and I won't go into all of them. But that's some of the work that we've been doing this year, is coming up with the specific metrics. So I never studied economics, but there is one thing that's really stuck with me through Vital Economy's guidance, and that's this lesson that we have to add water to the pool. The only way to bring money into the region is to access bigger markets. We can't continue to just cycle money through our own regional economy and expect to grow. We have to access larger markets if we're going to get bigger. And when I think back to the first few meetings, I feel like we all thought we were doing the right thing. We could do a few business opportunities and put some more water in our pool. We were feeling pretty happy about that. But as we've gone along this past year, we've realized that there really is much more water out there than we thought. And we should be thinking about filling up a bigger pool. This isn't about going out and starting a few initiatives and starting a few jobs. There's a huge opportunity out there, and we just have to reach out and grab it. So I want to talk to you about why we think that. And one of the reasons we think that is that our little region has many more connections than we thought we did. Almost every week we're finding that there are nationally recognized assets that we didn't know we had in the beginning. One of those is Storm Petrel, which is a software company that targets federal and state funding when there's a natural disaster event. And that fits squarely in our area of expertise of resilient communities. And it was an asset that was just right under our nose the whole time and we didn't know was here. Another one is Keene State, just got a lot of press for this carbon neutral biofuel, the life cycle renewables. And that's a company that's really poised for growth right now. And because of this Keene State connection, we might be able to bring them to our region. So these things just keep popping up. These were just in the last couple weeks or couple months. And these things keep popping up for us. And that's a really encouraging sign that we keep seeing new assets. Another big reason that we should be thinking about filling a bigger pool is that there's simply a bigger market out there than we knew when we started. Before in milestone 1, I think we were talking about a residential retrofit market that was around $39 billion. And the latest numbers for that are that if you combine the residential, institutional, and commercial markets, we have a market of $276 million. billion, I'm sorry. So the numbers are just bigger. And we've also found sources of information that went beyond green building. So when we first started this, we were talking about numbers of jobs that could come out of green building. And what we found in the last couple weeks is that there are going to be 13 million job openings in the green economy as a whole, and that's from some ONET data that we found, in the next 10 years. Someone has to educate people for those jobs. And not a lot of people, not a lot of communities are looking towards that opportunity. We also identified a new niche market where there doesn't seem to be any competitors. And that's bringing community scale resilient design solutions to communities that aren't in urban centers. A lot of people are thinking at the district scale these days, Washington, D.C., Chicago. A lot of these people are thinking about district scale solutions, but they're ignoring the small communities out there that might have less than 50,000 people in them. And that's where 50% of the U.S. population lives. People talk about urbanization, but we still have a very large amount of people who live in small communities. And we think that as one of those small communities, we could be educating other people about how we might do it. And then this is something I'm really excited about. The whole culture and conversation around green building in particular is changing. The industry is realizing that green building improvements have effects far beyond just saving a few dollars on energy bills. We now have solid evidence that things like better ventilation or daylighting features in green buildings help people be more healthier and productive. So when you consider about how much a company might spend on their building, that's only 10%. But how much they spend on their people, that's 90% of their budgets. And with that new data, that means a whole new wave of people are going to be drawn to the green building movement. And we just have to be positioned to leverage that new wave of interest. Another really encouraging sign is that over the past year, we've demonstrated that we can work as a region. Our regional planning organizations are coordinating in a way that they never have before. Laura just mentioned how she just came back from the Keene Chamber event. And BDCC also recently conducted an asset mapping session with ERCOT. So we started out thinking that, you know, as a bigger region, we should collaborate together. Over the past year, we've demonstrated that we can do that. And I think the important part of that is that as a bigger region, we can command more attention. We're just a bigger player, and nationally that matters. As a region, we're also stronger. We can leverage each other's assets instead of duplicating them. And as a result of that collaboration, we're seeing a lot of press that's kind of come to the fore in the last couple weeks. Keene State Today, this is their alumni magazine. Carrie Gaunt had a hand in having some and having an article in that magazine, and I think that reaches something like 10,000 of their alumni. BDCC spearheaded this article in Strat magazine, and recently that drew the attention of someone who organizes the United Nations G77 summit, which is this group that of people from developing nations to come together and talk together. And they were coming to Stratton for a retreat. And they asked one of our leadership members, Michael Knapp, to come speak to them. So just from this one article, now we have connections with a UN retreat. Like, it's just amazing how this has kind of snowballed, and we're really gaining momentum with a lot of different press outlets. So with that small progress report, I just want to remind ourselves before we get into the action team reports about the framework we've been working with. We have five action groups. And each has been refining what they've been working over the last couple months in their own sessions. But the reason that we're coming back together now is that we want these action groups to be structured and integrated in a way that if one opportunity is realized in one of these action groups, it will cascade around to the other ones and kind of accelerate growth in all of these areas. And the other thing that I think is important about having an integrated hub is that we know that our environmental challenges are systems. And our solutions are only going to be strong if one solution in retrofit market, for example, also has a parallel solution in our financing. And that's the only way we can make real change on the environmental side. So today I want us to be thinking about what you're going to hear from each of these action groups. I want us to be thinking about the connections between the action groups and how they can be integrated together to make bigger, real change. And then this is just a a mention of how the how we envision this framework going forward in terms of a strategic model. Here we have the active inputs, and these are our assets and the things that we have to work with. We want our hub to be able to be the think tank that takes these assets and transforms them into the economic outcomes that we want to see. But it's also really important that we want them to translate those economic outcomes into these other metrics. We call them the living the vision metrics. What I see about these living the vision metrics is that they are the ones that are holding us accountable to doing the economic development in the right way. These are metrics like sourcing food in our region, diverting solid waste, and things like that. I think the hub's role is going to be holding these two metrics in balance and making sure that we're accountable to both of them. So with that, I want to thank everyone who's been involved, and it's really your vision and your participation that is going to make these things happen, and I'm looking forward to seeing how the threads pull together today.
Great, thank you. Okay, so now we're going to turn to the action team reports. And what we're going to look at is a sampling of some of the projects that are being conceived of and developed, but not everything. So this is a sampling. There's some great projects, but keep in mind that there are a lot more that we're talking about, and new ideas keep coming up all the time. And that's really part of this process. It's to get this brainstorming happening, to find out about companies or ideas that exist in our larger community and begin to capitalize on those in this initiative. So anyway, there are five action teams, as Candace described: products and services, Knowledge Center, International, Agroforestry and Regenerative Agriculture, and FIRE, which is Finance, Insurance, Real Estate. So we'll go through these in turn, and with some of them we have sort of individual reports that will be happening. With others, the leader of that team will give an overview of the initiatives within that action team. With all of this, we're looking at a systems approach. So we're conscious not only of an initiative and its potential for success on its own, but also how it interrelates to other initiatives that we're talking about. So, we're looking at, one project benefiting another, and, sort of a rising tide lifting all ships. So as we go through that, keep that in mind, and we'll get on to the actual reports. So Taryn Fisher, let's start with the lean retrofit. Come on up.
Alex, can you also mention that people to jot down their comments on
Yes.
the sheet?
Yes, so there's a sheet you've got. Please jot down comments. We want this to be an interactive process with so many people. We don't have a lot of time for discussion, but we'd love to get any ideas that come to mind. And it could be ideas about the initiative you're hearing about, the opportunity that's being described, or other ideas that just come to mind as you're hearing about this one. So Taryn Fisher is with Antioch University, New England, based in Keene, and she'll be taking over for the next 10 minutes or so.
So that's the go button. And there's a red button.
Okay, great, thank you. Hi everyone, my name is Taryn Fisher from Antioch University, New England. Can you all hear me?
No.
Okay. Let's see if I can shout a bit and test to make sure everybody can hear. I am the program director of the MBA in Sustainability at Antioch. Can you all in the back hear me? Okay, great. Yeah. Okay. So I volunteered to lead the Lean Energy Retrofit team, not because I am an energy subject matter expert, but because I've led a lot of project teams and I thought this would be an opportunity for me to learn about energy retrofit so that I could apply it directly to my personal situation. I bought a home this summer, built in 1830, that, as you can imagine, is presents lots of opportunities for energy retrofit. When we set out this summer to move forward with this project, our objective was to take a look at the current state business process to conduct an energy retrofit, and we decided to narrow the scope of our effort on residential buildings located in the Northeast. And our objective was to say, well, what is the current state business process to retrofit a home, and what can we do to improve that business process with the goal of increasing the number of energy retrofits that are actually getting done? Just very quickly, for those of you who are not familiar with this term, to lean something means to basically streamline it, to take out the waste, to look for efficiencies. And what we went into the process, the hypothesis was that there were lots of opportunities to improve the business process to retrofit a home. And so that's what to lean means, to get rid of waste, whether it's materials, motion, defects, what have you. So again, the team's objective over the course of the summer was to identify the current state, to look for opportunities to improve the business process, and to make recommendations. As I undertook this effort, one approach that I decided to take as the team leader was to triangulate, if you will, my findings from three different sources. So one source of information was the team itself. The energy retrofit team was comprised of a good number of subject matter experts, people who really understand energy, and me. Then there was also the opportunity for me to use my own personal experience as a case study. The home I bought this summer, built in 1830, definitely needs to be retrofit, and I thought, as a homeowner, I can provide a data point. What is it like for a homeowner to go through this process? And then the third point of information in terms of my learning over the course of the summer, what does the research say? What does the literature say about this process? So this is a finding from an article presented by McKinsey in 2009. Energy efficiency represents 40% of the potential to reduce greenhouse gas. And benefits include reduced energy consumption, increased energy security, jobs, and so forth. And what McKinsey said at that time was that the U.S. could realize almost $1.3 trillion in energy savings if comprehensive efforts are put in place to overcome barriers to improve energy efficiency. Basically, energy efficiency investment pays for itself over time and mitigates the need to increase energy production capacity. So basically, we're leaving $130 billion on the table every year by not improving this business process. And so, you know, one of the things that was really frustrating to the team, we sat around the table and we said, we already know that these barriers and obstacles exist. It's incredibly frustrating. And so for the energy experts, they are deeply aware of many programs that are in place to help homeowners to retrofit their homes. From a homeowner's point of view, I can attest, it's really difficult to do. I'm still struggling. I had an energy audit done over the summer, and I'll tell you about that. And I'm still struggling with trying to figure out what to do about my own home, having gone through this extensive intensive learning process, I'm personally still struggling. And so that's a very real obstacle. Everybody knows that's out there, that's present. So we said, well, what can we do to overcome these barriers? So the first thing we said was, well, let's map the process from a very, very high level. Let's just map the process. A homeowner decides, maybe because they want to increase the comfort of their home, or maybe they want to realize cost savings in operating costs, that they want to do an energy retrofit. So there's an evaluation process. What are the problems? What are the opportunities? What are the recommendations? There's a process to hire the professionals to do the work. There's the completion of the work and the evaluation of the results. It sounds very, very simple. So let me just take you, before I get into my... So here's another way to look at the business process. We say, okay, there are all these homeowners, all of this market demand. If we could just develop a comprehensive plan of action, we could then potentially, you know, figure out what the bottlenecks are, break those bottlenecks, improve the business process. One of the big ahas for me as a homeowner, and for all of you in this room, this is, you already know this, but a building is a system, and there's a science to it. That just was, I had no idea about that. And so, you know, I just wanted to sort of tease apart some of the learnings. You know, there's this structural piece. And again, for all of you in the room, infiltration, exfiltration, insulation, windows, doors. There's a systems piece. What's your heating system? How do you heat your hot water? How do you cool your home? And then there's something that we spent a lot of time talking about in the Northeast, particularly for the older homes. What are the surprises that you encounter? Is the foundation sound? Is there rot in the sills? Is the roof leaking? And so forth. And so ideally, when you're looking at a retrofit, you're looking at the building in its entirety as a system. And you're thinking about these things with a systems approach. And that's really, really hard for a homeowner to do. And so one of the things that we, and before I get to, so just quickly, this is my house, built in 1830, 1,400 square foot home. The cost to heat is $4,000. Yeah. I had a blow test done this summer. I didn't know what a blow test was. I had it done. My house is supposed to be somewhere around 950 cubic feet per minute. It tests over 3,000. I now know what infiltration and exfiltration is, and I now know how important sealing is, much more so than insulation. When I first moved in, I was going to put a few windows in and be done with it. Well, not so much. So now I've got this really, really thorny problem to solve. And I'll just give you one example. My attic has no insulation. So I had my energy audit done early in the summer, and the auditor gave me this report that I, as a homeowner, really can't understand how to read it. But now I'm trying to find these contractors. I have no idea how to find them. I had two different people come in and look at my attic, and one said, oh, you want to blow some insulation into the inside of the roof. That'll solve the problem. And then another guy said, no, you want to put insulation on the floor. I don't have a clue what to do. And then he says, what kind of spray foam insulation do you want? I'm like, what are you talking about? So it's just really, really difficult. And, you know, I'm struggling. And so what our team came up with was, the importance of having, for the purpose of this conversation, what we're going to call an energy coach. And I know there are different programs and there are different energy coaches out there. But there's tremendous fragmentation, and I can tell you from my own personal experience, I have yet to find what I need to help me through this process. And it would be ideal if this energy coach were certified, kind of like maybe a financial planner is certified, and basically, you know, help me through this process from start to finish, both putting the plan together, putting the financing together, hiring the contractors, figuring out, you know, where was I at the start and where am I at the finish. And so, as we hear from the Echo Fire team later, one of the recommendations that our team is going to make is that when the fire team moves forward with its pilot, which you'll hear about in a bit, just a little bit, that part of their pilot include this role. So one of the things that we've learned, the other thing that we're going to recommend is that there's a team working on metrics. And it would be ideal if I had a way to say, my home is a five-star home, or whatever, whatever that metric is when I go to sell it. So it was a really kind of a bumpy process for our team, and we learned a lot about what everybody already knows, how difficult this is. But we think this is a really, really important role, and we think this will really help to move the needle in terms of increasing the number of retrofits and increasing the actual performance of those retrofits. So I'll pause there. Are there any questions? We have probably about a minute for questions.
Yeah.
Are there any questions about our process or our findings or our learnings?
Question. Who would pay for the coach?
Great question.
What was the question?
Who will pay for the coach? Our thinking is that the beneficiaries of the coach are going to be the homeowner plus the contractors, because one of the challenges is the contractors have to educate the homeowner, and it would in theory take some of the burden off the contractor so that they could focus on the revenue generating activity. So our thinking is that there may be a pool of funds created that would be the source of funding for the energy coach. We haven't worked that out quite yet, but the thinking is that energy retrofits pay for themselves over time. So there's money in the system. It's just a function of how do you get that money from here to here. And that's what we're hoping the next round of work will help us to figure out. I think I have time for one more question.
More of an observation than just the next step in the Eversource or utility scale end of it could be moving up from that, you know, up to $2,000 free installation level of work to, if the homeowner is willing to put serious capital on the table to do a deeper retrofit, the utility should have a next level fund that leverages that and, you know, sort of shares the cost of getting to that stage.
Absolutely. We've identified the utilities as part of the funder.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So I'm going to end there because I know we have a busy agenda. Thank you all very much.
Thanks so much, Taryn. So next up is Sierra Dickey from Green River. Green River is a Brattleboro-based software company that's done some, that's doing some really amazing work internationally as well as nationally. She's going to talk about the Resilient Design Advisor.
Alex Wilson of RDI for helping us drive our ideation phase.
and our three organizations will continue to lead this specific effort. So before I get started, I want to ask the room, what do you see in this picture? Just start talking out. Elliott Street.
A lot of brick buildings.
A lot of brick buildings.
Small town.
Small town.
Steep.
Steep?
Great.
Great. Okay.
Old.
Nice. Those are great.
Or the lights.
I'm not the lights.
So, beginning this work on the Ecovation Hub, there's one word that's been hanging around in my mind, and that word is volta. And in poetry, a volta is a line or phrase upon which the author's thinking takes a dramatic turn. And I think that this Ecovation Hub is like a volta. Voltas are identified by words like but, yet, or and yet. And all around us, thought is beginning to turn. So an exciting second act is coming after this phrase, and to me, it feels like and yet is written on every street. You can tell this is an ink drawing of Elliott Street, and it was done by my roommate, Casey Bird. So resilience is no longer a future issue. Planning and building and organizing for resilience has become a top priority in a lot of industries. I've had a bunch of examples, but I'm just going to do one from finance. One of Green River's clients is a company called GRESB, and GRESB rates the ESG components of real estate assets and portfolios. So ESG is environmental, social, and governance. And in 2016, this company, GRESB, rated $2.8 trillion worth of real estate value. So to give those numbers some context, we can look at everyone's favorite smartphone company, Apple, whose market cap was once $584 billion. So that's that number. $7.6 trillion is how much commercial real estate is owned by investors across the globe. And then GRESB touches $2.8 trillion of that. So this shows us that money is starting to flow to assets that are greener, better managed, and better suited to withstand future uncertainty. But the resilience sector is still a fledgling industry. Standards, regulations, governing bodies, and a cornucopia of products are yet to be born. Basically, in finance and fashion and agriculture and architecture, people want to plan for resilience, but they need to know what to do. Our Resilient Design Advisor tool is going to serve as experts in planning and active recovery situations. So to give you guys an example of what this thing could do, I want us to pretend that we're someone named Christina Brown, for example. Christina Brown is the resiliency officer at Boston University. In August 2020, Cat 4 hurricane strikes Boston, and the BU campus is damaged. So Brown's in charge of recovery effort, you know, handling the emergencies and planning as the storm passes and into the future. So she gets in contact with FEMA to get initial resources, and FEMA recommends the RDA. So she pulls up the RDA in her computer and types in the BU address. And a wealth of information is presented to her. So this, let's pretend that this is what her screen looks like. You can see that there's topographic information, demographic information, and predictions based on sea level rise, seismic hazards, and potential future heat waves. But these could really be anything that pertains to resilience, both physical and societal. Using this information, Brown is able to decide where she needs to install BU's emergency water supply. Right immediately after the hurricane, our tool could help her make that decision. But then a few days later, once all emergencies are taken care of, she can return to the tool and complete a deeper analysis, in which case the RDA would then be able to make more thorough recommendations. So this is another example of what her screen might look like. And the recommendations include things that she would need to do in the near future and things that she would need to plan to do in the coming months and years. So an example of a recommendation that the RDA might give is modify a field house so that it can serve as an emergency shelter, and put key card room access on a power over Ethernet system so that students can get into their dorms during power outages. So developing this tool out of the hub, we expect to employ 10 to 15 people at a starting salary of $50,000 or more. But beyond that, we're really excited about this opportunity because we see it as staking a claim in the rapidly apparent resiliency space. So basically, if we can have the first widely used planning tool for resiliency professionals, we'll have aligned ourselves with this sector in time for it to expand. So looking beyond the RDA for a second, we've also been talking about bigger projects that include software and IT. And basically, we've determined that this hub needs to produce a platform to qualify, track, and analyze the impact of its projects. Based on this feedback mechanism that's pictured here, a platform like this could learn from successes and failures and be able to make valuable recommendations. Basically, it would reward high-performing projects and encourage unsuccessful ones to get up to speed. And we'd see more and more successes feeding back into the chain. So we think that the RDA is an essential first step towards this future software platform. And these are our immediate needs. Seed funding, we're thinking that a $600,000 upfront investment will allow us to kick off development in 2017. We're looking for more businesses to sign on, regional and from elsewhere, to lend expertise and help guide the development of the tool. And then we're going to do audience research. We're still weighing the options about the goal and user. Is it FEMA? Is it the US military? Is it colleges and universities? Is it others? We're going to be determining that. So that's that. And in closing, I'll say that we think the hub's growth requires unique technological developments to cement our status as a center of excellence, and the RDA is just the beginning.
I think we can take a couple of questions. Anything jump out at you?
Yes. Yes.
Can you repeat the question?
Is it a new venture? Yeah.
How will you determine if it's for like larger scale, like military and such, or smaller scale? Like, is there a mechanism in place? Is there a way already to start thinking about that?
Yeah, I think in our discussions, we're really excited by FEMA and by the U.S. military because they're planning especially for emergency situations in which we could see this being really useful, but also because we want to do this on a physical scale, like, you know, what buildings need to be taken care of, and also societal scale. So when you look at a college campus or a military campus, you've got both the physical environment and the social networks happening like in a contained area. And so we think that would be the perfect, like, the perfect target, because we can work on both of those things with one customer.
Yeah, the funding may determine some of the initial direction this tool takes. You know, if the military comes up with funding, you know, we might initially gear it toward military bases, but then, you know, design it such that it can expand and serve, you know, many needs, you know, down the road.
Seems like the key technology is a version of kind of GIS mapping and sort of how quickly you can deploy that into customizable packages for people to do this kind of assessment and planning. Mm-hmm. Is that sort of how you're seeing it, or is not? That's what I got out of your presentation.
Yeah, I think there's a couple other factors, but in the example I showed, that's definitely part of it. It's using available data to come up with something novel, something that you're saying to the user that's novel, rather than them just looking on a Google map. But part of it too is taking information that's not available, not openly available publicly, but is readily available, like who are their vulnerable populations and showing that to them in a way that they'll understand. So yeah, there's a couple factors.
Great. One more question.
Do you explore targeting this to the Center for Disease Control, infectious disease outbreaks?
No, but that's a really good idea.
Yeah, the comment, have we considered looking at the Centers for Disease Control as a potential funding source or application for this? Great, great comment. Okay, thanks so much, Sierra. So as we go through these, you know, you can see the sort of the breadth and diversity that we're looking at. You know, keep in mind how these interrelate with one another. You know, we've seen a couple of examples so far. We'll go through a lot more, but you know, we'd love your feedback as to other connections that might be out there, other synergies that that come to mind, and funding opportunities and sort of the practical aspects as well. But I'd love to hear any comments and write them on that sheet that you got when you came in, or on a piece of paper. We'd love to if you don't have time to share those. Verbally, we'd love to collect those at the end of the meeting. Okay, next up is Kim Nace and Noe Hayes to talk about the Rich Earth Institute, a Brattleboro-based initiative looking at nutrient recovery from human waste.
Of the Rich Earth Institute and our research director.
And we're going to shift tone here a little bit, and we're going to talk about heat, because that's what we do day in and day out. So we have this program in Vermont that's unique in the country, turning human urine into fertilizer, which is then used locally by farms. And the first few slides just walk you through why we decided to do this thing that no one else had been doing, and you might wonder why anyone would want to.
And I have to apologize for the projector. It's not projecting certain colors, so you're not seeing on here what is showing on the screen. So use your imagination
here. The circle here, you see, is maybe there's supposed to be a big blue circle right here.
So this is about wastewater and wastewater management at the most fundamental level. And the thing that I want to draw your attention to first is that when we talk about wastewater, these are to scale in terms of the volumes involved. Wastewater is mostly tap water, about 60 gallons of drinking water flushed down the sewer, and then about less than 1/2 gallon, about 1.6 liters of human waste. So when you think about sewage and where it comes from, mostly we're talking about drinking water and then a little bit of human waste thrown in. So given these differences in scale, what can you do that we're not doing already? Well, one thing is you can address the issue of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution, because in that tiny little drop of human waste is most of the nitrogen and phosphorus that cause eutrophication, algae blooms, fish kills that are damaging our coastal waterways and our freshwater. 75% of the nitrogen and over half the phosphorus in that wastewater comes out of human waste. Now, those elements, nitrogen and phosphorus, if you have an agricultural background, you also recognize as fertilizer elements. And if you were to look at the total amount of fertilizer value in the urine a person produces in a day, it's enough fertilizer to grow the wheat that you'd use to produce an entire loaf of bread. So we're talking about a lot of fertilizer for each person every day. It's enough to meet a large portion of the caloric needs of a person, actually, is the fertilizer value of their own urine put back into agriculture. So we're losing this great resource. And instead of using it in agriculture, we're dumping it into rivers and making pollution. So we want to stop that. And we have other support, institutional support for this idea from all these organizations. These are our funding organizations so far to date. Mostly we do research, scientific and practical research at the Institute. And these four slides illustrate the four stages in the regional urine recycling program that we already have implemented and are enlarging and improving in the Brattleboro area. So we collect urine. I started out doing it informally from very, very dedicated volunteers, and now we've partnered with a septic hauling company who also does toilet rentals, and using they use their toilets that are designed to separate the urine, and they bring that to our facility now. That's that company. They transport it for us. We pasteurize it. This is a solar pasteurizer. We also have a trailer mounted unit, and then we apply it, or the farmers we work with apply that urine as fertilizer, mostly to hay fields. Actually, we're not using it to grow wheat. We're mostly giving it to farmers for hay. So this is a small project we started here as a pilot, and as a hopefully an inspiration to others, and as a way to find the pitfalls and figure out how to overcome them. And this summer we hosted the 2016 Urine Diversion Summit. We had about 30 participants from all over the country. We've had international participants as well in the 2 years that we've been doing this program. And it's bringing together scientists from multiple universities, inventors, and activists, planners, all manner of people, centered on this issue of urine diversion. And through the Rich Earth Institute's work, we've really put Brattleboro on the map as the center for urine diversion, urine recycling, and creation of new technologies through the research grants we've been getting. And I think that's my last slide. I think I'll turn it over to Kim. This is a slide that shows two of the different directions that we're headed in terms of products. New portable toilets that they don't have the blue goo in them. They don't smell like portable toilets, and they produce these fertilizer products we can process, sanitize, and turn into fertilizer. We're working with Best Septic of Westminster on that, Westminster, Vermont. And then this over here is a reverse osmosis system that is originally built for desalinating seawater. We've repurposed and re-engineered it to remove water from urine to make a concentrated fertilizer product, so it can be transported large distances efficiently, and it would enable collection in cities and transport to outlying areas. Noticing by this slide, Kim, that this is our older version, so the last slide is going to be our first draft, not the research that's just prepared. We put a newer version of this in a little bit too late to get the slide shared, but all the basic stuff is here. We're doing research in partnership with University of Michigan and Buffalo, and then we have a lot of local movement going on that Kim's going to be talking about.
So we've started in 2012, and the one slide that shows grants, I just wanted to mention that's kind of a progression of grants. And the Grassroots Environmental Fund gave us a seed grant of $1,000 in 2012, and they gave us another grant for $1,000. But now we're with the National Science Foundation. We've recently, with our collaborative partners in University of Michigan, they're putting $3 million into this whole research project. So we're very proud of that, and over time it's grown. Locally, we work with Best Septic, with Fairbanks Farm, with the Whetstone Valley Farm, and Hope Roots Farm. So we have endorsements from a lot of different people. We've had a great deal of support and enthusiasm locally. Over 100 people donate their year to the project. Over the lifetime, we've had at least 200 different people signing up to donate to the project. So there's really been tremendous support. We've also had support around the state with our legislators and up with the regulators in Vermont who have worked very closely with us. So this is a very, it's building, and we're getting contacted on a regular basis daily to ask people asking us, how are you doing this, what are you doing, and how can we also do it where we live? So here's some of the things that are happening with the Ecovation Hub. Recently, because we got this new grant, that's our portion of the National Science Foundation grant, is $830,000 over 4 years. We've hired new people. It's been a tremendous thing. That's literally just happened in September, and Abe and I are thrilled now to be able to share some of this work. One of the things I wanted to say about this is, in terms of the last couple people talking and the training that needs to happen, we have really become the experts in this field very quickly. It was really a niche field a few years ago. Now it's an emerging field. And that slide of 32 people coming this in August, I expect that to double next year. And we're inviting people from all over the world. We're the only urine diversion summit that we know of in the world. But there is a dry toilet conference in Finland that Abe's been to, and there are different things are happening. The sanitation
crisis globally that the United Nations has done a lot of focus on is really starting to move. So we have, these are our contributions. We've got 5 employees now. There's a new TMDL that means total,
maximum daily load,
thank you. The total maximum daily load of nitrogen that's going into the Connecticut River. There are literally in the last 2 months, the new draft permit for our whole river shed here has come out. And so we are gonna be working with the state of Vermont to see if urine diversion can be a possible solution to decreasing the amount of nitrogen that goes into the rivers. So that's one of the things we're available for. We have a deep, unique knowledge center for the field of global relevance. I love this word, disruptive. Disruptive new portable toilets, the ones that have been around forever are not very pleasant to use. The ones that we're building and inventing, they're going to be much more user-friendly. People will enjoy them much more. And there's a huge market. Polyportable is the largest portable toilet manufacturing in the world. Knows about these ideas, and so we can start to work with new people to roll out these new kinds of toilets. The vision, like I said, the summit's bringing people together through recycling our nutrients from our urine. We really close the nutrient loop. We close the loop, and that's people need to be doing that all over the world. We're not going to be able to sustain ourselves without it, and so. We're demonstrating that here. We have people coming to see it. And our flagship program, the Urine Nutrient Reclamation Project, is not a one-off demonstration project. It's an ongoing project. It's every single year we're continuing to collect, and our farmers are applying 3 times a year now. So we're really excited about that. So we are happy that we were able to hire the people that are working for us at a little bit of wage. And some of the next things for us. We need a new facility. We're still in my garage, and we're really ready to go. And so we are working with a few people locally to try to find the right home for the Richards Institute. We are looking for some legal assistance and help. We have some intellectual property. We have some potential patents and some spin-off businesses, and we don't really have that expertise in our purview. So people who are interested in supporting us in those ways, we do appreciate help. We would like to have more urine donors, and we need more people who want to put these new kinds of toilets into their homes or into public places. And we're in the process of looking for some more funding to further develop these portable toilets. So those are kind of things on the horizon. So, yeah. We usually have a lot to say for about an hour or so. So cramming what we do in 10 minutes is a little bit challenging. But,
great, so some
any questions?
Questions?
So why not just collect the gray water and separate it from the black water?
Sorry, can you say that again?
Why don't you just take the gray water out of a house and separate it from, and keep the black water separated from it and deal with all of the gray water in one collection and all the black water and other go different directions with it?
The question was why not collect all the gray water or collect all the black water? And the first slide with the volumes is really the main driver on that is that before you flush urine with a bunch of water down the toilet and with all the other gray waters or flush waters or black waters from the kitchen sink, it's a very small volume. And as soon as you start combining other streams with it, the volume increases and it becomes harder to handle and more complex. So since the urine has the great majority of the nutrients in it and is the smallest fraction of wastewater, that we decided to collect it separately to minimize collection costs, transport costs, all those things, maximizing the gains.
The slides don't show to you what is a urine diverting toilet system looks like, so we have that in the full presentation. It's a divided bowl and the urine is separated right at the source.
And just to emphasize what Abe was saying, among human waste, the urine contains something like 90% of the nitrogen and 60% of the phosphorus and 0% of the bacteria or pathogens. So, if you keep it from getting contaminated in the first place, your treatment of it is much simpler. Anyway, I wanted to just point out that from my travels around the country and writing about green building practices, this is huge. And this is going to, I believe, revolutionize over the next generation human waste treatment. And so I think Brattleboro is getting a name for being at the top of the pack in this technology area, where there's intellectual property out of which a whole bunch of businesses could eventually evolve. So, you know, I think we're really fortunate to have the Rich Earth Institute here. So keep up the great work.
If urine is already sterile, why do you need to pasteurize it?
It's not really sterile. It's more typically pathogen-free. So that's a little bit different. Actually, sterile, even water is not sterile. You know, that means nothing is living in it. But because these divided bowls could risk some fecal contamination, that's why we do the pasteurization step. We're working with the state of Vermont. We have the only permit in the country. It's a 10-year permit for our mobile urine pasteurizing unit, which we take farm to farm and pasteurize the urine at each farm before we put it on. That unit, which is very small, is actually permitted as a wastewater treatment plant. Because that's the only way they knew how to do it.
Would it work with cow urine too? Can you collect dairy farm urine?
It's very similar. It's not a big difference chemically or physically. I think that the difference is that we're trying to take something that's being flushed into sewers and then into rivers, remove it from ending up in the rivers, and redirect it to farmland. A lot of farms, at least around here, are already recycling the waste from their livestock.
So for public facilities or homes not in your region that could give you the urine that's been diverted, what's your vision for what would happen to the urine?
What would you, the question was if urine were diverted from public facilities or buildings, what's our vision for what would happen to it? It would go through the same process that the urine currently goes through, where it's transported to a farm, sanitized, and then applied typically to hay.
So you need to develop an infrastructure all over, I mean, here you have an infrastructure, but I'm just saying.
Oh, other places.
Other places.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
One of the purposes for starting the project here was to be able to develop tools, technologies, devices, systems, methods for doing this, and then make the information available and the products available so folks other places could just buy a package of tools and implement it. So they could do similar things, but they wouldn't need to do all the legwork that we've been doing.
And it's not just about technology, it's also about sort of attitudes about human waste and dealing with the sociology of it.
Well, that's what I'm talking about, is it sounds like you need to develop a culture or education before you throw out all the, you know, get these. I mean, one of your bullet items is install permanent urine diverting toilets, so it seems
for
like.
The National Science Foundation, I didn't mean to cut you off, but
that's
for the new grant, we have a national team of researchers who are coming to Vermont next week, actually, and we are going to be doing for the next 4 years a social research component of this. It's almost half of that grant is for the social research component. At the end of it, we will have developed educational materials that will be for the general United States population.
So that could be a bullet item on that slide there. That's huge.
Yes.
Exactly.
Unfortunately, we have to move on, but I'm hoping you can stick around and,
answer questions
at the end of the meeting. In the middle. We have a board meeting at 6:30. We're getting out of here after that. Great. Great. Thank you, Kim and Abe. Next up is Andrew Guy. Andrew is with Unity Homes in Walpole, New Hampshire. Unity is a manufacturer of panelized homes, sort of really cutting-edge homes that are very energy efficient. They can be made net zero energy simply by filling the roof with solar panels. And Andrew is going to talk about some innovative wood products that may have potential in this area.
I'm actually going to concentrate on one particular innovative wood product called cross-laminated timber. The presentation that I'm giving is the last one that falls within the action team of green building products and services. You may remember that Candace talked about the five different action teams, and within each of those action teams, different opportunities were identified and work groups were created to pursue those opportunities. So I've been involved with the work group that's focusing on engineered and innovative wood products that could draw on the resources and assets of this region. And we ended up focusing on CLT, or cross-laminated timber, for most of our work. As I said, this is the last presentation of that from that first action team, and I'm going to be followed by Abigail, who's going to be talking about the Knowledge Center. Her presentation was scheduled to start at 4:45, which is 5 minutes ago. So I'm going to try to be quick. I assume that the presentation is going to be available online, so if I gloss over some of the bullet points, they'll be available for you to see afterwards, and I can stick around for a few minutes. Well, I'll be here during the break and then afterwards as well to answer questions and chat with people. We had a good team working on this. The working group, kind of broadly representative, some people from the industry like myself, Allison and Jim from Ford Panel, Bryce Hereford, who did really a lot of the groundwork for the work committee and made a lot of good connections. Lee Schutte, who's with Keene State, also has good connections and background. Lisa Kuhneman, whose recent claim to fame is having been one of the organizers of the Tiny House Festival in Brattleboro, which was a great success. So she brought wonderful perspective to the group. And Candace provided a lot of research support. And Jim Haywood, Frank's partner, also was instrumental with the consulting support. So it was a nice, broadly representative work group. We initially started thinking about a few different options as we kind of narrowed our focus. One was the CLT, the cross-laminated timber. One was wood fiber insulation, which is a product that's quite commonly used in Europe, but not so much in this country yet. We also looked at some that are crafted wood products. We put together a great presentation on these really interesting, highly crafted, different kinds of wood products spanning a wide variety of uses that also look quite interesting. But we really had limited time and resources and needed to focus. And the organizers of this meeting today suggested that we bring props. It's a long time to be here in this room, and we're competing with a pretty lovely view out there. So I brought a sample of CLT here that you can look at during the break, cross-laminated timber. This actually is created in northern Quebec, where there's a huge supply of slow-growing black spruce trees that regenerate. But because they're slow-growing, it's very tight-grained, and you'll see that, which adds to the strength. You'll see the finger jointing in here, whereby they take small pieces of wood and make them into very long pieces of wood. So the sizes of the CLT can be quite large from quite small, sustainably harvested trees. I also brought in a sample of wood fiber insulation. This is something that at Unity Homes we're actually buying by the container load from Europe because it's not produced in this country, but there are some companies that are distributing European products like this in this country. It comes in different thicknesses, different densities. It's available as a fiber that can be blown, like cellulose or fiberglass. So again, we like that it's wood. We like the vapor permeability of it, some of the building science characteristics of it, and we think that there's a future in this as well. But we decided to focus on CLT because it's something that has been getting a lot of press lately. And there feels as though there's sort of this wave that's growing, and we wanted to explore possibilities for kind of riding that wave here in this area, in this region. So it's kind of like plywood on steroids, CLT. They take large pieces of wood, an inch to an inch and a half thick, sort of 2x6 size, and they lay them up this way and they lay them up that way, and you can have, you know, varying thicknesses, varying numbers of plies, and you can create huge sheets with this, you know, 8-10 feet wide by 24, 30, 40 feet long. So you can imagine that there are great structural possibilities with this. The manufacturing process starts with the raw material, with the timbers basically, and that's a huge resource here in this region. The foresters, the loggers, the people getting the trees out, then the sawmills who are sawing the stuff, processing it, has to be dried, has to be graded, and then the material is laid up in these big presses with glue, and these giant sandwiches are created. And then there's machinery that's been developed to mill these huge sheets. So for cutting window and door openings, for cutting angles, for making smaller pieces out of larger pieces. Again, a lot of the technology, a lot of the machinery comes from Europe, where this has been around in a big way for at least the last decade or so. Lots of buildings being built with this material over in Europe. There are a number of significant advantages to using CLT as compared typically with steel and concrete. So the sweet spot for CLT seems to be in the sort of 4-story to 10 or 12 story size range, multi-family apartment buildings, office buildings, that sort of thing. Much less embodied energy in the wood as compared to steel and concrete. Much less waste involved when you're working with this material. It can shorten construction time because a lot of the work can happen off-site. The material can be fabricated to the right size and dimension and then just delivered on a truck, and popped into place with a crane. It goes together very quickly. So working with CLT, it's a shortened construction time, which has cost savings and other advantages. It tends to be safer kinds of construction, less dependence on skilled site labor, which is a huge problem in the construction industry right now, finding skilled labor to get projects done as the whole construction industry is ramped back up after the recession. Better thermal performance with this wood than with concrete, typically, and steel. And it has the benefit of sequestering carbon as well when you're using this wood as a structural material. Here are a couple of photos of a new building that's nearing completion down at UMass Amherst. It's the Wood Design and Engineering Building, I believe it's called. And Benson Wood, the sister company of Unity Homes, had a hand in kind of guiding the installation of these CLT panels, which came from the company up in Quebec called NordicLam, Nordic Engineered Timber. So it's a sort of a demonstration project, and some of the movers and shakers in the CLT movement, if you will, are located at UMass Amherst. So Peggy Clouston and Alex Schreier are working to promote, you know, they're doing research about CLT and working to promote it. This picture was taken recently of a classroom space that's nearing completion. But there are some really impressive projects happening all over North America now. This is the tallest CLT building in North America that they recently topped out. This is a picture of partially complete, but this is up at the University of British Columbia, 18 stories high. You can see the kind of the concrete core there, but then everything else is CLT. So pretty impressive project being done with this. A lot of opportunities we think here in this region that could be based on CLT, taking advantage of the wood supply and dry kilns that are here, and kind of the timber production industry that's already present, the infrastructure that's already present in this region. There's a possibility of establishing CLT manufacturing here. It's not a slam dunk. There are a bunch of other parts of the country that are sort of eager to have, you know, be the centers of CLT manufacturing, including up in Maine, where they're making a real push for CLT. But if we were not to have manufacturing necessarily in this area, that's not to say that there couldn't be other ways in which we could benefit from this movement that I think is going to really grow exponentially over the next few years. So that could include developing this area as a center of installation expertise. So the CLT might be fabricated somewhere else, but we might become known as kind of the go-to area if you find people who really know how to put this stuff together. Or maybe this becomes the go-to area for people who really know how to design with this, or who really know how to engineer with this, because it does get tricky when you're engineering buildings, you know, with huge sheets of wood that are going to move, that are going to be subject to change. It's not like engineering with steel and concrete. So there are different ways in which we could imagine kind of taking advantage of this opportunity. There could be training and consulting that could come from here and be offered to other areas. Certainly there's already work happening in higher ed, and as this Peak Ovation Hub is making connections between different centers for higher education, it's this whole idea of connecting the dots and reinforcing the research that's happening with about CLT and the design and engineering of it. And there's also the possibility for exploring other ways to use CLT. I'm thinking about the presentation that Lee gave, where he was sort of focusing on smaller handcrafted kinds of wood products, but you could think about CLT being used for emergency shelters perhaps, or kind of interior applications where maybe there are different kinds of wood being used than would typically be used for sort of structural CLT. And so there are opportunities there as well. Candace just gave you the 2-minute sign. So lots of regional assets here having to do with the forest and the wood and the companies that are working with it, the industry and academic connections, designers and engineers. We have this long tradition of precision manufacturing in this valley, and you know, that's something that also we could be building on. The fire action team, which you'll be hearing from, Dan will be talking about that. There could be financing and incentive packages for working with CLT. There's certainly good rail and highway access to this area as well. Different ways to look at the opportunity value in relation to the goals of this Ecovation Hub. So some big numbers there in terms of the potential for CLT penetration in that sort of 1 to 10 story building market, you know, as high as 1.5 billion in sales for the shells of these buildings, the enclosures. There is a tremendous amount of low-grade wood supply that could potentially be used in CLT that's manufactured here. And if there was to be a manufacturing plant that was set up, that would create jobs, direct and indirect jobs, that would bring in, you know, new money for the tax base, and potentially contribute a substantial amount of money to the local GDP. Next steps include continuing to sort of pay attention to the latest research, continuing to make the connections and exchange information with people who are doing the research, but also with industry experts. And I was talking with Adam Grinold of BDCC and Bryce Hereford before this meeting started about a meeting that's going to happen tomorrow. So connecting people, connecting the wood suppliers, connecting the processors of the wood, and then connecting potential companies that might be interested in actually creating manufacturing CLT in this region. I think that's it. Do we have time for a question?
Sure, we'll take a couple of questions.
You,
Peter.
The UMass program focuses quite a bit on the steel connectors along with the CLT construction. I have no idea where those steel connectors are made, but I suspect they're overseas. Does the steel connectors also represent a business opportunity connected to the CLT system?
It does represent an opportunity connected to the CLT. The steel connectors for the UMass building actually were supplied by Nordic, and they were fabricated up in Canada. So it sort of made sense that they're the ones who are supplying the beams with the holes already in them. They're going to supply the steel connectors that have the holes that mate with the holes in the wood. But that's not to say that they couldn't be made elsewhere with CAD/CAM and BIM manufacturing now, and using 3D models. It's pretty easy to kind of spread that work around. So that's a great point that I hadn't really thought of.
Another question.
Andrew, you talked about the advantage of being up in Canada with black spruce. We don't have black spruce here, so what's...
Well, out west, they're building CLT with other kinds of materials, you know.
The question is there wood, are there wood species here that would work for CLT?
And that's one of the challenges, I think. And that's some of the research that's being done at UMass and other places. How applicable is our wood basket, so to speak, for CLT? And it could be that it's not particularly applicable to what people think of as CLT and how it's being created now, but there might be other uses for CLT. The biggest use of CLT right now is as mats for equipment in wet areas, for example. You kind of see these sort of, they look like rafts, basically, and when you're driving heavy equipment over wetlands or sensitive environments, you know, that's another form of CLT, and that is perhaps less, there are other species involved with that than in the photos that I showed of the buildings being built. So there are different applications that could take advantage of different species, and I think that's an interesting area of research.
Great. Afraid we've got to move on, but thank you, Andrew, and I forgot to... mention in introducing Andrew that he's part of the leadership team of the Ecovation Hub, and is thank you for those efforts with that. Our next presenter is Abigail Walton with Antioch, New England. She's also a member of the leadership team of the Hub and doing great work not only at Keene and, you know, the educational institution there, but through the Center for Climate Preparedness and Community Resilience, on whose advisory board I sit. So it's been great to get to work with Abby on that.
Thank you, Alex. So I have a very soft voice. Taryn, can you hear what I'm saying? Okay, good. Raise your hand if at any moment I lag. So I'm the last person before the break. I know that everybody after the Earth Institute presentation probably wants a bio break. So I'm going to go quickly and just tell you that my work, along with others in this room, has been to figure out how does the higher ed community across this tri-state region, and possibly even into Bennington County, come together to support, through research and delivery of matriculated degree programs and certificates and non-matriculated capacity building offerings, how do we support the work of this Ecovation Hub? And, you know, really the way that we think about this is through becoming greater than the sum of the parts. What you see on the screen are the logos of the different organizations and institutions that were part of the process of developing our action plan for this education and training consortium. And what we all do is wonderful, but we also know that what we all could do together could be even more powerful and have a greater impact. And referencing back to Candace's talk at the beginning about bringing more water into the pool, what we need to think about is how do the programs and the other capacity building work that we do bring people outside of this region into this region to access that capacity building, and how do we take our expertise outside the region and deliver it outside of this tri-state region with the revenues coming back here. So that's the basic model that we've been thinking about in doing our work. So the opportunity is to create this National Knowledge Center around these two key areas of green building products and services, you've heard a lot about that already, and community resilience, which you've also been hearing about. And to do three things: to create new knowledge, to provide training and capacity building, and also to demonstrate and implement different approaches in the region that can serve as real world examples, to be that living laboratory that people from around the country, from around the region, from around the world come to this area to learn from and to experience. So many of these pieces you've heard before. I'm going to highlight the one about merging green building science with craft. So this recent survey showed that nearly 80% of construction businesses are having a hard time finding qualified skilled labor. That's one thing. And at the same time, these new green technologies that are being introduced require higher levels of building science knowledge. And what we expected would happen out of the work that all of us did over the summer is that each of these other action teams would come up with very cool new products and services that we in the higher ed sector could be looking to build some programming around. And so we already heard about a certified energy coach as being a new occupation that's been identified. We heard about urine diversion and the recycling expertise that we could be training people through sustainable ag programs to really be expert in, and to take that knowledge and capacity and take it all over the country and all over the world. And we just heard from Andrew about the need for design and installation expertise around this cross-laminated timber product construction method. So we expected that this process was going to generate new ideas for us that our higher ed institutions, in partnership with other key organizations in this region, like Bensonwood, like CION, and others, could be collaborating on delivering, building capacity around and delivering. So a very basic graphic here. First piece, creation and discovery of new knowledge, so engaging in research and testing. We know that our institutions can go after grants, we can go after contracts on an individual basis, and that we will be much more effective in doing that if we're collaborating across institutional boundaries. So looking at a partnership between SIT Keene State and Antioch, or Antioch, Keene State, and GCC to go after some grants and contracts to do research that we can't as easily access on our own. Implementation and demonstration, showcasing existing assets, right? So we have a lot of assets in this region, and one of the next steps for us is to develop an actual visual map of this region that places all of those assets in a way that people can see what's here and how they can access it. And then transfer and capacity building. So won't take a lot of time here, but I do want to hone in on this idea of living laboratory. And all of the assets that are here. I want to give the example of Bill White at W.S. Badger, which is across the river in Gilsum. So I was at my local coffee shop on Main Street in Keene. I like to go to Brubaker's. And there, hanging as one of many flyers, was a little poster, a little 8.5 by 11 poster, of a workshop that Bill White is going to deliver on how do you become a visionary business leader, how do you be an entrepreneurial business leader and start a B Corp business. Now, what many people may not appreciate is that Badger, thank you, you can't hear me, Badger is one of the highest rated B Corp companies in the world, higher than Patagonia, right? I mean, just unbelievable asset that we have in this region. And I can guarantee you that the catchment area for Bill's workshop right now is probably from Marlow, New Hampshire, maybe down to Ridge, New Hampshire, possibly across the river to Brattleboro, and maybe as far east as Peterborough, in terms of the number of people who are going to see the ad for his workshop and come participate in it. And what we need to do is to create a catchment area that is Pittsburgh to Washington, D.C., to Boston, to Montreal, as a starting place, and bring all of those people here to benefit from the kind of expertise and knowledge and skills building that this region is uniquely positioned to deliver. So in terms of the Knowledge Center, these are the four identified pathways that we looked at. Green building, sustainable ag, building climate resilient communities, and then the green finance, insurance, and real estate piece that Dan Yates will be speaking about later. We looked at the ONET data for the top 20 green economy occupations, and we looked at where our higher ed institutions and other key partners already deliver programming to meet these occupational needs, where the gaps are, and therefore where the opportunities are for us to fill those gaps. And so looking from the master's level, bachelor's, associate's, professional certification, or continuing ed, all the way to high school diploma, and looking at where the opportunities are. Anybody who wants to get into delivering programming around wind turbine service technicians, you are going to be very happy that you did that. This is an incredibly fast-growing occupation. So this is all the way down through climate change analysts as a job occupation. So we've begun to do this work. The next step for us is to refine the kind of analysis that we've done in terms of looking at what we already do, where the gaps are, and what we need to build in order to better service those needs. One example of an educational pathway is what you see up here. So, you know, people can come and enroll in Greenfield Community College. They can get a certificate in renewable energy and energy efficiency. There are direct employment opportunities there. Maybe at some point they decide to go back to school and they want to become a sustainability specialist, and they go and complete their bachelor's at Keene State. And then maybe they come to Antioch to do our MBA in sustainability, to do an environmental studies master's degree, and then they go on to be a supply chain manager, a green supply chain manager. They go on to be a climate change analyst or a sustainability director for a corporation. So those are some opportunities. And then partnering with CEON, you know, being able to touch people who are in the trades and to really build their capacity around these new technologies and green building. So this is a very quick and dirty analysis of the economic value for this region based solely on matriculated degree programs and certificates. This doesn't show you the economic value of actually creating that whole wealth of non-matriculated degree offerings that we know we can do in this region and bring revenue in. So this is a very conservative estimate. But, you know, looking in year five at revenues to higher ed institutions of $8 million and economic indirects and induced of up to $1 million, I would consider this to be a very conservative estimate. So I want you to think about where people are going to come from and how they're going to know that this Ecovation Hub exists. And I want you to think about what contributed to the growth of this region originally in terms of our economic viability. I can tell you that at one point in history, Keene and Richmond, New Hampshire were in competition for the railway to come to their cities, as their towns, as destinations. Keene won. Okay, today Richmond barely has a crossroads. I think there was a general store it closed. Keene is now a municipality because it had the railway. We have a railway right outside here in terms of the Vermonter and Amtrak coming up from New York City and points beyond New York City. And what I would love to see is people getting on that train and coming up here to go to a workshop at Bensonwood, which has facilities to deliver this, coming and learning these skills and having an opportunity to come and experience the reason that we all live in this region, which you can see right outside this window. So thinking about the kind of advertising that the Ecovation Hub can do on kiosks, on billboards, in Penn Station, all the way up and down the Amtrak line, and down in South Station in Boston. Thinking about creating a structured pathway to eliminate the centrally geographically isolated reality that many of us experience. So how do we overcome that? We need to build these structured pathways, and we need to use the existing infrastructure to get people here. So that's it for me, and do we have any time for
sure, we'll take a couple
questions?
Of questions.
Okay.
Yes.
Bill Murray will hit me if I don't bring up the fact that our appraisers are aging out. We are soon going to be absent appraisers. It's going to be a long time to get a loan. And for that matter, appraisers don't understand highly efficient, high performing buildings. If they don't understand how the building works and they don't understand the benefits of their users, they can't confidently do the job. And it's a big stumbling block in in our way, specifically with doing significant work to existing housing stock.
Yeah. So you think we should be delivering some training for appraisers?
Yes. Real estate professionals. Yeah. The house is a system.
Great.
The market is a system.
Great. Thank you.
Great. Awesome. Okay, I'd like to cut this off right now, and we're going to have a short break. I emphasize short. We're a little bit behind. We're about 10 or 15 minutes behind. When we come back, we're going to get into international programs, regenerative agriculture and agroforestry, and bike.
Hello, Greg. Haven't seen you in a while.
No.
Excuse me.
You're in Waitsfield?
The company's in Waitsfield. I'm still down here. Right?
You're still down here.
Yeah.
Okay. And I recall you're doing commercial storage?
Utility scale storage, megawatts.
Okay. Okay.
We also do integrated with a house.
International Action Team, and Stephen Dotson is going to speak to us. Stephen's with another Brattleboro company, One Report, that does reporting internationally for large Fortune 500 companies, corporate environmental reporting and corporate sustainability reporting. So, Stephen.
Good afternoon. Is this loud enough in the back? Yeah, okay, I gotta wait. I also want to acknowledge up front my partner in this leading this action team was Bethany LeClaire of SIT World Learning, and they were invaluable in finding connections in the area and leveraging their network, which is spread out all over the globe. So first off, I want to address the name of our action team, because you're going to hear some ideas that aren't quite international in scope. The way I would reframe this is to say Force Multiplier Action Team. We were started later in the process than the other action groups, and we weren't topically organized around products and services or financial tools or whatnot. So we were formed with the hope that we could help find more water to put into the pool. Foreign markets, foreign funding, foreign opportunities to bring new manufacturers here, more water in the pool, to exploit that analogy. So moving forward, you'll see what our proposition statement is. This region is already a leader in developing unique educational and economic assets and possesses an exceptional network of contacts both locally and abroad. Leveraging coordinated these assets and relationships will enable accelerated growth of the Ecovation Hub through a directed effort to form new and strengthen existing economic and educational relationships. This will build regional capacity for sustainability-oriented commerce and help to enable climate preparedness among small to medium-sized Class D, as they're called by the EPA and other federal agencies, communities, which we fall in as having less than 50,000 people. Now, we played with all sorts of interesting ideas, and many of them, they were great ideas. They could possibly bear fruit in this region. The question is, who's going to pick it up and run with it? And that's where all of those ideas really hit a roadblock. So in terms of finding those force multipliers, We came back to the point of maybe it's not time for international markets. Maybe it's time to look at the fundamentals of who do we have in this community who can take a good idea and run with it. So we shifted from looking at market tools and financing tools and opportunities to attract new manufacturers here with things like the foreign trade zone that Brattleboro enjoys a designation of, and the EB-5 financing tool, which bundles foreign investors for major infrastructure projects. For instance, if you wanted to build a CLT plant, you would need a lot of capital up front. It would be very appropriate for an EB-5 program. You'll see here, there's some roadblocks that make these things possible perhaps in the future, but not accessible to us right now. So these tools to multiply our effort are just not here yet. So we positioned ourselves to reposition ourselves to ask the question, what can we do and how can we create an environment that attracts and retains the young talent that the Ecovation Hub needs? So imagine a young person goes through our wonderful knowledge center, which you just heard Abigail describe, and what happens then? Well, most typically, they leave our region. They find jobs elsewhere. So we ask the question, what can we do to retain them? And that's where this idea of the Connecticut River Green Bridge program comes in. I'm going to try and run through this quickly. I know we're behind time, and I think this concept kind of speaks for itself here as well. This brings together our higher ed institutions, our workforce development organizations, our trade organizations and training organizations, and local housing assets. And it hopes to bring down the median age by keeping people here, retain the existing graduates that are coming out of all of these institutions of higher ed, and establishing a pipeline for them to be channeled into green businesses, whether they're building businesses, software metric businesses, what have you. So looking forward 5 years, if this were to start tomorrow, what would be our vision 5 years from now? 18 new graduates are selected annually to be housed in co-living arrangements in Keene, Brattleboro, Greenfield, and placed in sustainability positions with green firms in their respective counties. In addition to just having a place to live and a place to work, they're given opportunities to pursue kind of vocational discernment and really find out a better sense of what's going to keep them here, what is their calling, and how can they get rooted in a bigger way. And also provide them the social support and networks and opportunities to actually have the life that a 20-something would like to have in the region. So networks like the Southern Vermont Young Professionals Group, things like that would be important to tap into. How does this advance the Ecovation Hub goals? Increases our regional population, retains who's already here, increases our youth, retains graduates, strengthens the workforce, increased entrepreneurism, as there are strong correlations between youth and increased likelihood of starting small businesses. And our higher ed partners enjoy the ability to tell the stories of these local successful graduates who are there then hopefully more eager to give back to their institutions as alumni. So trends that support this opportunity. Millennials, starting early 80s till late 90s, these folks are choosing jobs with a social mission and environmental awareness, all else being equal. They want to have soul in their work. And we offer a lot of soul in this region and in a lot of the work that we've been presenting here today. We have a disproportionate number of green employers, as has been shown, and the ability to train people for those employers. So we've spoken over and over again about how this region needs to become more young. That in of itself has become a goal of many town plans, regional plans, state plans, economically. So this is a known quantity, known problem to solve. So we have some proven concepts that I want to point out here. This model has worked previously. It's worked in a multi-stakeholder situation, which is the Philly Fellows Program. Draws upon all institutions of higher ed around the Philadelphia metro area and places them in social justice related nonprofit positions. And we have a single stakeholder model in Haverford House, which is solely owned and operated by Haverford College and places people similarly in Philadelphia job positions. These two models, depending on who in the community wants to buy in, this is the basis that we would pursue this idea any further, but still very preliminary in its conception. So who would need to be involved for success? Our education partners, our housing partners, our workforce partners, and then the retention and programming partners that I mentioned before. So I'm not going to go through all our crazy acronyms here, but. And if you're a member of any of these institutions and wondering why you haven't heard of this idea yet, it's because it's still an idea. If we were to start it tomorrow, what would it look like? And how would we get to 2020? This is how. I'm not going to read the slide, but I will trust that we all will receive the presentation afterwards. And if you care to know, you can dig in and really, really go into the details here. Again, highly theoretical. It starts in one town. It grows outward. Start with a pilot, build on that proven success, and eventually try and build a bit of a community around the program itself so that alumni of the program have a bit of a community locally that they can tap into, and incoming students, newcomers, will have that older generation that has graduated from the program to draw upon as mentors. So what does this mean economically to the region? Using data from the 2013 American Community Survey, four-year college graduates spend a significant amount more in the local economy. So not only are we strengthening our workforce and providing the inputs to make a lot of these other business ideas possible, we are also boosting our tax base, increasing our consumer spending on local goods and services, and you can see this proportionally with different degrees of education, the impact that comes there. If anybody has questions about methodology, I know there's a lot of data folks in the room. I'm happy to talk about that afterwards. And that's me. So I was going to keep it short. If there are any questions.
Any questions?
Is the yes, E5 program still alive after the Vermont fiasco?
The EB-5 program is very much in effect and operational as a nationwide program run by the feds. The question that, the challenge that we have is, if you're an investor with a choice of 49 other states that haven't been embroiled in scandal, why would you choose it?
And it's going to be continued?
Vermont?
Not in Vermont, in nationwide. Congress is going to reapprove it?
If I knew what Congress would do.
So, Stephen, before you leave, I know you didn't really get into it in your group, but could you talk a little bit about what the foreign trade zone could be for the region?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, do we have any foreign trade zone members in the room? I'm just
our
board members. RT, you're not on the board, are you? No, okay. I think about 8 years ago, this town was applied for and received a designation as a foreign trade zone. And what that means is that people who wish to import goods here under certain designations, SIC codes of materials, can bring those goods here more cheaply and avoid some of the excise taxes and duties on that importation until they sell that product to the consumer market. So in terms of cash flow for a business, you don't actually have to pay the duties on something you've imported until you have the purchase order to sell it to the consumer market. So you already have cash in hand to deal with the things you're importing. Also, so there's just a number of tools within it, and I'm sure RT and other people at BDCC who've been working with FTZ on this could clarify a little bit more about what that means for folks. But essentially, you can bring things in a lot cheaper and avoid the upfront cost and taxation until you then sell it to the consumer market.
Great, thanks. Okay, thank you, Steve. Okay, next up is Ted Montgomery, who's going to be talking about regenerative agriculture and agroforestry. And this is another later formed group in this Ecovation Hub, but doing some really exciting stuff. So, Ted.
Start with some quick definitions. Let you just read them. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the definitions. These are working. The reason why we're working on this. Two maps of the globe. Top one is roughly 300 years ago, around 1700. Bottom one is 10 years ago. What you're looking at is massive deforestation globally, which most of us probably know about. What our action group, our intention is to start to reverse this trend by making intact forest ecosystems profitable, economically viable systems, and to implement regenerative agriculture techniques that build topsoil, increase carbon content, sequester carbon. Roughly half of the excess greenhouse gases in the atmosphere come from the way that we do agriculture and the way we have treated our forests. Some quick numbers here. Our region, our four counties. Of those 1,900, the ones that have less than $20,000 in annual sales is over three quarters. That's sales, that's not income, that's sales. Of those 77%, the average sales or value in agricultural terms is about $6,000. Average farm size is about 180 acres, 55%. Well, these are all from US Census data from 2012. Jim Hagwood helped us with this action team, and the big takeaway that we took from this is that there's a lot of underutilized land, both agricultural and forested land in our region. 1.2 million acres, rough estimate of forested land in our region. Most of it privately owned. On the left here, that is total agricultural sales or value annually in our region. Left side is current status. Right side is what we, our working group, thinks the potential is. So adding, whoa, no, wrong button, 30 million per year in value to our farms, and down at the bottom is 44 million in value from our forests and new crops, new products. The big question is then, how are we going to do that? Our working group came up with a list of dozens of ideas for regenerative agriculture and agroforestry, literally dozens, 30 or 40. And we culled that list to these 14 that we think hold particular promise to meet the Ecovation Hub's goals, creating economic activity, new businesses, new jobs. Top two here are, well, I'll just go ahead and read that list. To determine which of these we think had the most value, most opportunity, we created a poll. And our coordinators took that poll, and then we sent it out to our broader list of people involved in this working group, which is about 50 to 60 people, professionals in this three-state region. And on the next slide, which is the result of those polls, these things all hold the same position. Okay, you can't really read the text, but like Food Connects is the top and Super Fresh from the Field and Forest is the bottom. So these are the poll results. What I'm just going to point out here quickly is that of this broader list here, there's not a whole lot of variability. People thought that many of the things that we proposed have substantial potential. The ones that we're going to highlight today are Food Connects, food distribution system, medicinal forest herbs, nut production, and this invisible one, which is mushrooms. grown in the dark, right in my skin, subterranean. Mycelium is white for the most part. Food Connects. This one sort of boggled me when it ranks so high. I didn't get it. So we started asking, I started asking, why do people rank this so high? And what we got back was that small-scale farmers are really hurting for good distribution systems for their products. It takes so much work for them to go out and sell their product themselves at farmers markets, at their stands, to co-ops, to restaurants. If they had a distribution service, it just really helps them tremendously. And these are the goals that they see the Ecovation Hub meeting. Organic, food security, increase local consumption, and support local farmers. Next one, medicinal herbs, Michelle Conner. We had about 6 to 7 business cases that our working group vetted. This was one of them, medicinal herbs. She is a local acupuncturist and herbalist, and she presented a business case for this. This is Golden Seal. On the right here is it's an understory crop. It is indigenous here, though it's very hard to find now, over-harvested, but it can be grown. Some quick numbers on this. They're pretty astounding. This root at our local co-op sells for $170 a pound. It's really potent stuff as a medicinal herb. These are numbers that she developed in her business case, using a lot of assumptions and a lot of market research. At $30 to $70 per pound wholesale, she estimates $45 to roughly $100,000 per acre in gross value. And that doesn't include the value-added potential of these herbs. And this is one herb of dozens that we could be growing here profitably. Nuts. Hazelnuts, chestnuts, Daniel Hardigan presented a business case to our working group. He's from Walpole. Very enthusiastic about nuts. There are many people in this area who are growing the new neo-hybrid chestnuts and hazelnuts. This could be a source of vegetarian protein, could be a source of locally produced oil, and it could be grown on the edges of fields that are now a high maintenance area on many farms. So replacing the having to whack back the invasives with a cash crop. The farm on the left is Badgerset Research Farm in Minnesota, one of the premier research institutions. Daniel went there to study. The left-hand edge is chestnut, the right-hand edge is hazelnut, and you can just barely see sheep grazing. An additional crop that's possible intergrazed amongst hazelnuts and chestnuts. Some quick numbers he and I ran through, you can't read it, but a non-timber forest products calculated that Virginia Tech put out, Jim Haywood sent that to us, but there are many of them out there. And the long and short of it is that when we put in a bunch of assumptions, we came up with the possibility of roughly $5,000 in gross, no, a net yield per year based on those assumptions. We were pretty conservative with our assumption. Now that's after 10 years after planting. So it's gonna be a while to recoup the investment, and these sorts of details need to get worked out, how to finance things like this. Mushrooms. At the census, the 2012 agricultural census, Vermont had about $42,000 of registered sales of mushrooms. I talked to a farmer on Saturday who I think she's over $100,000, just one farm. It is exploding as a crop, or as that's not even a crop, it's a kingdom. This is a shiitake yard at Amazing Planet Farm. This is chaga. This mushroom or fungus is used in every oncology ward in Japan. It has tremendous cancer-fighting properties. Unknown here, our culture is pretty mycophobic. The Orient has been working with mushrooms for thousands of years. some quick numbers there just to give people a sense of the potential. This is a shiitake here. That one mushroom, I'm going to just read these in case you can't. Medicinal value, specific ailments that have been documented, hyperlipidemia, arteriosclerosis, herpes simplex, eczema, AIDS, allergies, hepatitis B, measles, stomach ache, high blood pressure, flus and colds, diabetes, headaches, and health maintenance. 3 to 4 mushrooms a day. This is the next tier below those four among the, from that list earlier. And I'm going to just leave this up. These are sort of our goals. There's the $74 million in new annual economic value that we think this working group could bring to our region. A couple of ways that you can find it up there. I'm going to let you read that while I take questions. And I'm going to go back and forth between that slide and this slide. A couple of our team are here. Gary, raise your hand. Tatiana. Anyone else from our working group? Amy Louise Beffer, raise your hand, please. And Richard Burkfield from Food Connects. And Jenny Dunkley, thank you. So, questions? No questions. Yeah.
The in New Hampshire, the spring kickoff of OEC, the energy and planning thing of New Hampshire, their lead thing was agricultural in New Hampshire. Starts with solar, goes to greenhouses, goes to food distribution, goes to the users, and eventually every citizen in New Hampshire eats that stuff. So New Hampshire's working on a total vertical machine for agriculture.
Wow. Other questions, thoughts, Ben?
Just an observation that it seems like a lot of the products that you've identified are things that could be grown profitably at a relatively small scale.
Yes.
Which makes the, in terms of the knowledge base expansion, programs like GCC's farming program, which is kind of a micro farming program, could really focus on this kind of opportunity and really have an impact for small growers or newbies, you know, who don't have access to a lot of land or capital to really make use of some of this kind of stuff.
Tatiana had a business case here that was the solar and agriculture boat. Incorporating solar into agriculture productively to use the land for both. Yes.
I just wanted to add a comment that I think that our working group needs to keep working on, which is to calculate the value of keeping land forested or increasing the amount of perennial crops in the landscape in terms of carbon sequestration, as well as mitigation, as well as resilience and adaptation towards climate change. Because as we see with these hurricanes like Matthew, the importance of forested land, the land that can absorb water, land that can be resilient towards drought. So that's something that we haven't, we haven't calculated yet, the value of that, but I think that needs to be considered as well.
Yeah, resilience is one of our goals with this. I think it's the fire team.
Great.
Thank you so much. We brought some samples here, pawpaws and hardy kiwis and chestnuts.
So our final action team this afternoon, before Frank provides some final remarks, is the FIRE team, which is Finance, Insurance, Real Estate. It took me a while to get used to that acronym, but some people are quite familiar with it, I guess. But Dan is president of Brattleboro Savings and Loan here in Brattleboro, and presenting with him is Kevin Warner, who is a consultant in Baltimore, who's advising on some really exciting opportunities. I'm really thrilled at what this team has come up with.
So thanks, Alex. I'm going to keep my comments brief because I really want to focus our time on the presentation that Kevin has put together. But as Alex said, FIRE stands for Fire, Insurance, and Real Estate. finance, insurance, real estate after we burn it down. So financing, we're trying to find ways to finance green industries. Now, whether that is financing Rich Earth Institute's expansion, whether that's financing the development of a plant that is going to manufacture cellulose insulation, whether that is financing the construction of workforce scale housing that is green, whether that is financing the reconstruction of commercial buildings, old commercial buildings, in such a way as to make them energy efficient, such as was done with the Brooks House, such as being looked at in Bennington with the old Hotel Putnam, and financing highly energy efficient, even to the extent of being net zero, residential properties. And I'll come back to that in a moment. We're looking at this from a private investment standpoint as opposed to traditional banks, because we have challenges due to regulations as to what we're capable of accomplishing. On the insurance side, we're looking at it from the standpoint of, how does insurance play into this, both as perhaps an investor in the entity that we are hoping to form to provide these financing mechanisms, but also looking at it from the standpoint of what's the impact on the insurance industry today because of climate change. I mean, you'll see some numbers that are pretty staggering. And if we can get the industry going so that we're building more and more buildings, homes, commercial buildings, multifamily properties that are generating far smaller carbon footprints, then we're going to reduce the impact on our climate, we're going to reduce the impact on the cost of insurance. Also, green is healthier. So you think about it, if your home is green, very likely it's going to be a healthier environment in which you can live, and that's going to reduce the cost of health care, reduce the cost of insurance companies having to pay for health care, and things of that nature. Now, I'm going to talk briefly about the residential side, and Jeff brought this up before, I think, when Abigail was making her presentation. Appraisals. Jeff Gephardt led a valiant effort to undertake find ways to really value green-built homes. In particular, commercial buildings are a little bit easier because those are based on income and expenses, but residential properties, it's all about how much does a 1,600 square foot net zero home cost to build versus a 1,600 square foot traditionally built home. You're not going to get the value right now of those highly energy efficient improvements. So we are seeing appraisers aging out, as he put it. Now, some of our appraisers, we've had to go farther and farther afield to get appraisers to do work for us. So is there an opportunity to, working in collaboration with our educational team, to create a program to educate appraisers in the green industry? And how do we get the industry to start to adapt standards on that? So there's a big challenge there. In the conversations I've had with people about residential construction, I've run into a lot of roadblocks of people saying, you're spinning your wheels. It's just, the industry's never going to adopt this. It's just, you're wasting your time, you're wasting your money. And I just find that to be an unacceptable answer. I'm a traditional banker. Yes, we have rules that we live by, but it's time to think differently. It's time to think outside the box. It's time to find a way to make it happen, not simply to look for the ways to say, it's easier just to say it can't be done and let's move on and do something that's more fun. I think this is a great opportunity for us. I'm really excited about it, and I want to be part of it. We're going to create jobs, both direct and indirect. We're going to generate revenue, and it's going to help our economy locally. But to help us, courtesy of Vital Economies, we were introduced to Kevin Warner. So I'm going to just read a few bits from his bio and then turn it over to him. Kevin serves as Emerald City's National Director of Distributed Energy and Water Efficiency Project Demand Generation. Working collaboratively with local communities, businesses, municipal governments, utilities, workforce, and environmental stakeholders, Emerald City's collaborative develops and facilitates aligned capital to achieve a triple bottom line of resource efficiency, social diversity and inclusion, and community financial equity. he has successfully developed and launched Emerald City's Renew suite of solutions for municipal and multifamily residential customers in Cleveland, San Francisco, and Seattle, and is expanding these programs throughout Emerald City's nationwide markets. Kevin has worked at the intersection of environmental, clean energy, and community development investment for 30 years with municipal governments, investors, corporations, institutions, real estate developers, and nonprofits. His expertise is in market development, acquisitions, strategic partnerships, and capital formation. And I think you'll be really excited to see what he's about to show you.
Yeah. You really should hold your applause, okay? By the way, I wrote that, so, you know. I wanted to emphasize a couple things. First of all, really happy to be here. It's a really exciting initiative that you're working on. As Dan said, in my day job, I actually go around the country and I help regional collaboratives develop, launch, and fund initiatives just like this. I worked on launching a Cleveland initiative in Cuyahoga County called the Clean Energy Finance Hub, our Renew Multifamily Finance and Project Development platform in Seattle, San Francisco, and I'm actually going to be in Providence tomorrow talking about it. For Rhode Island, and that RENEW stands for Retrofit for Energy Efficiency Works, and it's really about delivering finance and project development expertise capacity to owners of multifamily buildings who don't have the time to deal with. And you heard earlier from Taryn, you know, what do I do with this stuff? How do I execute this? So the idea behind the presentation that you're about to see is to create that platform, that suite of services under an umbrella that delivers finance, assurance that my investment's gonna perform for real estate and other sectors in the green economy. But what you really need to know about before I delve into the details is I'm originally from LA. Hold your applause. Which of course is the former entertainment capital of the world. I now live in Washington, D.C., which is the new. So one of the things I was wrestling a little bit with the word catalyze versus harness. I think it's a little bit of both. We're talking about catalyzing and harnessing. So we're going to talk about the mission. We're going to talk about the value proposition. That's really important from a finance and investment perspective. What is the value proposition of what we're talking about? So the problem, the opportunity, the strategy. What are the market drivers, both local and broad, that's going to help with the formation of capital? What's the go-to market? What are we trying to do here? Who are we trying to face? Who are the customers? Who are the off-takers? Who are the product suppliers? What is our market strategy? And finally, what is the platform and what is the pilot? What are we going to build and what are we going to do first here in the Tri-State region? So, these are our four pillars. Economic development, you can read this stuff later. Deep decarbonization of the economy. Impact investing. We need to align capital with the impact we're trying to achieve. And a focus on regions. Regionalism is really important. If you think about the energy economy, energy is not national. Energy is regionalized. It's not even by state anymore. You have different utilities. You have different regulators. You have different municipalities. You have different issues in different places. It's a very regional economy in the energy sector. So we need to focus on regions. And all of that comes together for the EcoFire platform. FIRE, Finance Investment in Real Estate, which is about developing, decarbonizing, aligning capital, and ultimately regionalizing the system. What's our value proposition? So this is about purpose built. All right, we are setting out to design a finance investment in real estate platform that is built for a specific purpose, not a big broad purpose, a very specific purpose. Catalyze growth and scale for an activated marketplace with committed, intentional outcomes. Those are our four pillars, remember those? not just finance, insurance, and real estate, but finance, insurance, and real estate for a clean, resilient economy. So it's very, very specific. What's our problem? We have slow, uneven absorption. Despite great strides that we've made in greening our economy, it's slow. And I'm going to show you some data points in a few minutes that are really going to be staggering. Some of you may know them. I was surprised by some of them. And I've been doing this not really 30 years, but I'm not that old. You know that. More like 31 years. You know, resilient design is something that a lot of people don't understand. It's a pretty basic concept if you really think about it. But the consumer doesn't understand it because they don't think about it every day. And that's part of our problem. We have to break through the barriers for the customer. There are very few friendly financing solutions for customers right now. And I'm going to show you a couple of data points on that. The underwriting and valuation process, as you've heard, is really struggling because it operates under a century-old model. We've got to change that outmoded model. Assurance is absolutely needed. We don't drive our cars without insurance because we want to be assured in the case of a problem. We have to provide assurance of the performance of green systems in buildings. And it's confusing. You heard from Tara, it's just confusing. Like, what program do I do? How do I subscribe? How do I enroll? Who's gonna manage this for me? Do I know I'm getting what I'm asking for? It's just really, really challenging. So these challenges are particularly acute for small and medium-sized communities, small business and lower income customers, because they are on the margins and they don't have the resources to figure it out. So putting these communities at risk from an ever-increasing climate-related problem. The problem just gets worse and worse if we don't address them now. Again, getting back to that purpose-built model, we're building this for a specific type of market deployment. So what's our opportunity? Again, purposeful green finance and assurance, filling market gaps, being a pipeline developer, not just an operator of a program, not just a writer of checks, but connecting those two. Imagine in your head a pipeline. I have opportunities over here, whether it's companies or projects or buildings. I have money over here. I'm going to facilitate that. That is really, in the finance world, that's a merchant bank model. Not an investment bank. It's not a commercial bank. It's a merchant bank. Someone who does deals, who puts it all together and figures out the problem and then solves the problem. It's a platform company. Right? It does multiple things, but it doesn't try to do all of them. It partners and collaborates with local experts, and it channels capital into those partners and those collaborators. In other words, use the best-in-class knowledge to solve the problem regionally. In the tri-state region, you are blessed with a significant knowledge base of experts and collaborators, as you've already heard. Many of those experts and collaborators have opportunities that they can tap into, but for access to capital. Therefore, the need for ecofinance. And finally, Vermont is an unusual place in that it can take advantage of two things that are pretty important for this platform. One is the benefit corporation statute and the captive insurance laws. Two things that can be very important in going to market nationally, not just here. All right, so we're gonna start burning through this pretty fast. So hold on, buckle up. Opportunistic approach. We're really trying to address those gaps and innovate quick to market. We don't need regulatory action to start EcoFarm, and that is really important for capital partners. Social impact DNA, hardwire the public benefit of the entity from the get-go and make sure that we deliver on it. It's a unique model in that it's that merchant banking model. I cannot find too many green merchant banks out there in the country right now, one or two I can think of. It's collaborative, it's not siloed. We're working with the regional stakeholders to solve the regional problems and then taking those
those learning experiences and exported them to other regions. So 80% of the toolbox is built, and then you localize with the 20% collaboratively and locally. So who's our customer acquisition network that's already built? Think about green real estate industry. Who are the people you talk to when you're doing a real estate transaction? Realtors and brokers, builders, suppliers, you know, architects, community banks and lenders, insurance agents, associations, intermediaries. These are people that we're already doing business with and we trust. So we've already built a really good customer acquisition. All right, so what's our strategy? Organize and fund, launch EcoFire. Initial focus is the tri-state region as our pilot, leveraging the assets of the Ecovation Hub, demonstrate scalability for a national platform. We're not talking about doing this only here. We're talking about housing it here and growing it nationally and potentially internationally. It functions as a proving ground. Let's do cool new stuff here and then export it. And it generates economic and environmental data exhaust. This is Frank's terminology, and I love this, from a diversified portfolio of green buildings and resilient infrastructure. Dan did not mention that I actually co-managed a private equity fund for a while. And one of the most valuable assets we had was data exhaust. We were able to pull in more capital to our fund because we had performance data from our previous investment portfolio. That's a portfolio management approach. It's extremely valuable, and it's exportable. So these are the goals for economic output for EcoFire for the tri-state region pilot only, by the way. 250 to 300 EcoFire jobs, regional corporate jobs here, and you'll see how we're going to get there. $50 million of direct regional economic impact, meaning dollars coming in. An average 20% net reduction in energy water consumption for buildings and properties that we help to finance projects on. This is the pilot that we were talking about earlier with regard to lean retrofits, 500 unit pilot. 250,000 square feet of retrofitted commercial, non-residential. 10 megawatts of new renewable generation and energy storage. We have to talk about generation and storage at the same time because the technology is available. And leveraging at least 8-to-1, I think we can do 10-to-1, and you're gonna see that in a minute. So why do we need this? Because we already have green banks, right? Connecticut's got a very successful green bank, Massachusetts is starting one, New York has one, California has one, right? Why do we need EcoFire? The states already have green banks. Well, let's look at the Connecticut Green Bank, just the commercial PACE market only. For those of you who don't know, property assess clean energy, basically funding improvements to your property using property tax assessments. In 5 years, we went from one bank to 14 banks. From zero in annual investments in Connecticut to over $100 million last year. We had two commercial PACE states with statutes. Now we have 32. We went from $9 million in commercial PACE loans to $217 million in commercial PACE loans. That's national, by the way, not just Connecticut. Yet, in New York, they had $850 million of applications alone. They haven't even launched the bank. So there's a lot of pent-up demand out there. In California, which does have a commercial PACE program, the largest investor in the commercial PACE program in California, who's already invested $1 billion in California, estimates they've only tapped 0.5% of that market in California. That's how big the market is and how big the gap is. So these quasi-public and public entities are great, but they're not enough. EcoFire is a privately motivated, commercially viable venture. It's designed to augment and work with these public entities, but not replace them. A couple of facts. I love these. I'm going to let you just read these, but look at the numbers. Doubling of the market. 70% of our homes do not meet current energy code. $39 billion
of unmet need just in current energy upgrades for the U.S. housing stock. Jobs, more of them, higher wages in the green economy. This is a great one. So this is the U.S. Commercial building energy efficiency market, the energy services companies, right, the ESCOs. They're doing $3+ billion a year, and they estimate that they're only penetrating 5% of the national market. And that's just large-scale commercial. But this is the one that really caught my attention. The insurance industry forecasts a 30% increase in property and casualty losses from climate-related events over the next 20 years. 30%. If I told you that we're going to have 30% mortgage default in the next 20 years, what would you do?
Sell my portfolio.
Sell your portfolio. You're going down. So let's take that one and go with a little bit deeper dive. Has anybody participated in the Climate Reality Project? That's Al Gore's nonprofit. So I was privileged to attend about a year and a half ago in South Florida. And this is the chart that really caught my attention. This is from the insurance industry, by the way. Wow. Worldwide extreme weather catastrophes. You don't even need to look at the numbers. Just look at the trend. And that's what's happening in the US. By the way, this is the insurance industry numbers. Most of it is hitting us. In 2012, the US bore about $119 billion of losses from climate-related events. So when Dan talks about the nexus to the insurance industry, this is it right here. If we don't do something, we're in trouble. We thought the banking bailout was a problem. This is a lot bigger. So our platform. This is going to get a little dense, so bear with me. Platform company at the top, Ecofire, it's a benefit corporation. Underneath it, you have funds. You can have equity funds, you can have debt funds, you have regional operators like the Tri-State region. You could have a 501c3 entity that can pull in grants from government and nonprofits and foundations. So lots of different diversity in platforms. You've got your collaborators, your channel partners. We talked about them for a second a few minutes ago. And then you have three entities or three umbrellas underneath, which is a banking or a CDFI, Community Development Financial Institution, for those of you who don't know that term, an insurance and a services company. And you'll see why those are important. So who are the players? Banks, foundations, the Federal Home Loan Bank has a program, the Federal Reserve has a program, housing finance agencies I work with a lot, they all fit in the banking platform. The insurance companies are insurance, risk analytics, construction services, all fit under the insurance platform. And the services platform, it's data, it's research and development, it's technology, and it's materials testing. Lots of things you've already heard about today. Now, what do they do? You can see what those are. At the bottom, those are all feeding into the national and regional business platform. And there's that information exhaust that comes back to the top, and it's reprogrammed and rechanneled for continuous improvement. What are the core offers? Lending and investment, we talked about that, insurance and green asset management, building information supply, service and support. And these are the folks you're going to recognize, some functions and people who are already in the Ecovation Hub and in the regional economy here. But you can see how there's a place for everybody to play here. And that's what's great about this platform, is it's not siloed. It's really designed to service all of their activities. And again, this is just a snapshot of what the product and service types may be. Again, following those lending, insurance, and business services opportunities. And we talk about the retrofit and the green coaching here, by the way. I validate that because I'm using that service in my Renew program. And people will pay for it. So what's our Tri-State pilot funding plan? We're looking at $300,000 to $400,000 of cash for starting up, that's planning and pre-launch. It's about a 12 to 24 month startup period, and ultimately the regional platform would need $1 to $2 million of initial capitalization into the platform company. You can see how it's broken down and some of the funding partners that we're looking at, philanthropy, public partners, mission capital, and Series A investors. And what does this look like over time? Because we don't want to just do it here. We don't want to be one and done. We want to be a national platform. We're going to start it here in the tri-state region. That's that $2 million capitalization. Again, services, lending, and insurance are the three platform offers. But then we start growing it from this base of operations. The second one, and the third one, and the fourth one, and on and on and on. And over a 36 to 72 month period, we're looking at $16 million of capitalization into the EcoFire platform and leveraging 10, or $160 million of total investment into EcoFire and its related platform companies, investments, and projects. So these are some of our economic assumptions, what we're really driving for in terms of jobs and economic growth. I'll let you read that. That's it, catalyzing finance, insurance, and real estate for the clean economy. Maybe harnessing instead of catalyzing, but I think you get the point. That's EcoFire. Dan, in closing remarks.
We will be working. We'll be working over the course of the next 6 weeks on further development of the natural business plan so we can get this launched. And we will have that ready to present at the milestone board. Again, I'm really excited about the opportunity to work with Kevin. I'm excited about the opportunity to have an impact and to do something that is not traditional and address some of these issues head on as opposed to saying the next generation can do it. It's time for this generation.
And you just mentioned the bank's role in this.
Sure. As I mentioned when I had started talking to some folks about this whole process and getting some feedback that it was a waste of time, a waste of money, Kevin's not doing this for free. Although he's doing it for us really with an eye on the long term. But there's a cost for his time. At this point in time, while it may not end up that way, my bank is picking up the cost of Kevin's efforts because I feel that strongly about how important this is. With that?
Any quick questions? All right, well, I'd like to turn things over to Frank. First of all, another thank you for. The EcoFire is really at the heart of what we're doing here. So we saved it for last to help show how the pieces can be put together. So now Frank's going to talk for a few minutes about connections and new opportunities.
Yeah, I'm going to do in 5 minutes or 7 minutes what we were going to do in 25 minutes to make sure we stay on time. I do want to emphasize that EcoFire is the enabling infrastructure for all the other platforms that were mentioned today, whether it be equity investment, whether it be innovative investments in deep energy retrofits. And this project is going to move forward with private investment. We're not relying on government funds for this. This is going to move forward on a private investor basis. Now, what I'd like to ask you all, we've had presentations from these five groups here. Okay, and there have been obvious connections between FIRE and the Knowledge Center. They validated, and Taryn over here in Products and Services talked about the need for this energy coach. Kevin just validated that EcoFire wants to have that energy coach as a key component of funding and financing an enterprise going forward for every retrofit done. But they've also identified a whole bunch of, in FIRE is going to value a company using products and services out of this if they have people that are trained by the Knowledge Center. So there's a whole interrelationship here. What connections did you all see that you didn't think were here before? Okay, that you, in your own mind before? What opportunities are you seeing that each of these presentations together could make possible to create more jobs for this region. More economic, yes, Bill.
I'm seeing it addressing the aging demographic and trying to figure out how you take care of the people who are here who are aging out of living independently and need services and housing.
Okay, who else? Come on now. I know it's at 6:30. Yes?
I'm on a developer. I'm working on developing 500 houses for retired and workforce housing in Winchester.
Okay.
And you guys open up a big door here.
Okay. How do we open up a big door?
I realized that I don't have to do it all myself.
Okay. That's a good...
And the big issue will be to get it through, but the secret is workforce housing, I believe.
Okay. Absolutely. Big need for workforce. Yes, Andrew?
I was going to say, it seems like there's an enormous need. One of the presentations focused on who are the brokers of all this information and how do you make the connections between, say, forestry and the Knowledge Center and how to finance that forestry idea
right.
that you've just been trained to do at one of these institutions. And so that brokering function and how you pay for that seems like a key intermediary piece here.
So you're talking about the brokering of the opportunity and the people who want to take advantage of that opportunity.
Right.
Good point, and their enterprises around the country. You get placement fees for that kind of stuff. You get finder's fees for that kind of stuff. So we ought to mark that down as, Candace, one of the opportunities creating that brokering mechanism. Yes, Taryn. Did everybody hear what Taryn just said?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this systems approach is something really important that's unique in this area. Yes?
And further piggybacking off of that, there seems to be a real regional opportunity for succession planning for land that's not currently in production and play matchmaker between land trusts and then young people who have had educational opportunities in agriculture and various programs. Who don't know how to find land or are looking for land.
Okay, as you are thinking about these, please make notes on your own note papers that we've given you, these little things here, so you can say give them to us as you leave today so we capture these. And put your name on the paper if you want to be active in it, making it work. Yes, sir.
Well, I am gonna pose an opposing view here, perhaps.
Sure.
It felt that this presentation was a little bit antithetical to all of the presentations came before, and maybe I just didn't understand. But the model that you're presenting is it feels corporate, it feels expansive and grow, as opposed to the theme of so much of what I heard before was local and sustainable and small. And it just felt like a whole different world to me. And I'm concerned about that, I have to say that.
Do you want to address that at all?
I think it's a great point. So the idea behind the EcoFire model is to build a kind of a self-contained, self-sustaining regional platform that can then be replicated to other places. So every region has its own design, but it uses the same tools. This is really an aggregation model. The way that you attract capital at large scale that can then be distributed locally is by creating a very large pipeline. If you want to attract capital from, for example, impact investors, it's very difficult to get them to talk to you when you want $20,000. More like $2 million is what they want to talk to you about. There are some capital providers that won't talk to you if it's less than $10 million. So the idea here is really to create a local solution that can tap into national resources and then replicate that model.
So it is intent. But one of the things we have emphasized repeatedly, even though we're doing local solutions, we have to come up with solutions that also have national reach or way beyond this region, because unless you're bringing enough jobs in and enough money into this region, to solve our problems and create our opportunity. You don't have enough scale here to get there. So you've got to get more scale in order to get there for the local region.
Well, I would also say that if we are successful in innovating a solution to the challenges that we've talked about here, why would we not want to share that in other regions? Doesn't mean that we have to run that nationally, but why wouldn't we want to see that replicated?
Right.
It's also the finance and insurance and real estate analogy to filling the pool with more water.
Okay.
Could I answer your dissent?
Sure,
we started with a premise that we needed to replace the economics of Vermont Yankee. Now that was a huge economic machine. It was a huge cash generator. I mean, that's millions and millions of dollars that were coming out of there for energy. And we got to replace it at a similar scale of what Vermont Yankee used to be.
Thank you. Okay, other
my
questions?
Opinion.
Other comments? Yes, in the back.
I can see how the cross-sector approach this, like this can be applied to new service organizations and social service organizations. Same kind of line of thinking of pooling together and going after funding as a group, supporting struggling organizations as a group instead of one-on-one and just kind of fighting.
Good point. Yeah, one of the beauties of this hub is that you're right, we've aggregated a bunch of players and assets in this. We need to do the same other sectors. One point I want to make, and I'm going to close this section off at this moment with the final slide, and then we'll turn it back over to Alex to close the meeting. I'm going to give you one number that was not listed up here. There's approximately, there's an area called impact investing that a number of people have mentioned today, including Kevin. These are people who invest to achieve social, environmental, social, and governance transformation in economies to create more sustainable approaches to economies. There's about $39 trillion worth of dollars being transferred from ultra-high net worth individual families in the United States to millennial descendants. Those millennial descendants.
How much was that?
I think 39 trillion.
I think that's an underestimate.
I didn't say that's an underestimate actually, but it's about 39 trillion. Okay? About the millennials that control a portion of that only currently control about 10% of that asset base. But they represent 50% of the investors in the investment capital in impact investing. Which is the kind of, this is the kind of patient capital that wants purpose-driven investment. And they are looking for entities like this to, whole initiatives like this to invest in. But they need scale in order to make their dollars go to work for them. And they don't want just a return for their foundation, their family office. They also want an impact that can be measured that's beneficial for the environment, beneficial for communities, that can be replicated around the world and around the country. That's the audience from an investor standpoint we're going after. And that's why we're building the Ecovation Hub the way we are, to attract some portion of that capital to come in through this enterprise. And Ecofire can act as the investment attractor, whether it be for regenerative agriculture, whether it be for products and services, whether it be for workforce housing. All those things that we're trying to achieve to improve the community can only happen if we've got a scale attractor, okay, in here. So that's the way, and it also from a system standpoint. Now finally, I want to show you that all those presentations you saw individually, we've actually gone through and analyzed what all those presentations say about what the potential is for creation of jobs and economic impact against the ultimate goals. We're looking at, these are the total jobs here, 813 total jobs. Remember, 600 jobs is what Vermont Yankee got. We lost at Vermont Yankee. And a significant amount of these, even though we say we wanted to attract these kind of jobs over 46,000, just in Ecofire, the minimum wage level was going to be $50,000 to $75,000. just in Eco Fire, which is one of the largest generators. We've actually, so far, with just the ideas that have come to prime time readiness, is about 49%, we think, of what our goal was for the next 5 years. We also, from a capital standpoint, are about 43% of new GDP, 62% of new business creation, and 50% of green economy investment. Okay, so we're making progress, at least plan-wise, to get to where we want to be in 5 years towards this. So what I want to close with and turn it over to Alex is, we have a measurable plan with measurable strategies, and now from milestone 3, which is ending today, we're launching milestone 4 tomorrow morning. On November 30th at SIT, Kristen, is it 3:30 to 6:30? Whatever, same time?
To be determined.
To be determined. That is going to be milestone 4 when we, which is both a communication of what all this results in going forward, a completion of this phase, and the launch of implementation. Over to you, Alex.
Yeah. Can you advance that?
Yep.
So I just wanted to follow Frank's comments by inviting you all to come to the Milestone 4 meeting and to point out that, you know, that itself is partly a celebration of what we'll have created over the past year, but also a launching point for what's ahead. And this initiative doesn't end at the end of November with Milestone 4. It really begins at the end of November. And the leadership team of the Ecovation Hub is working on kind of a governance model to move this forward and keep it going. Because a lot of these ideas, as you can tell, are going to take years to develop. You know, some can be implemented quickly, some are going to take 3 years, 5 years, or longer. So keep in touch about it. Again, if you have ideas, if you've written them down, pass them to Kelly on your way out. If you want to talk with any of us, our contact information can be found through Kelly, or I can provide a business card. We'd love to hear your ideas. You know, one of the beauties of this whole process has been listening to ideas and sparking new ideas out of what we hear. You know, I'm expecting that after today's meeting, even though it's sort of late in the process, we'll hear some new ideas that, you know, we hadn't been aware of. So keep those ideas coming, get involved in the process, stay involved in the process, and again, thank you all for coming today.